Good morning.
Good morning.
We are pleased today to have Governor Deval Patrick with us. Governor, when you led the state of Massachusetts, you were a champion of civics education. Now you're in business, and you're still passionate about civics.
I am. For all the reasons we've heard this morning.
For all those reasons.
You know, we are as President Jefferson, in his riveting presentation this morning, alluded, we are unique among nations and exceptional, I think not because of our extraordinary wealth, as important as that is, or our extraordinary military might. You know, nations of great wealth and great armies have come and gone with the winds of time. We are unique because we're the only nation in human history organized around a handful of civic ideals. And we've defined them over time through struggle as equality, opportunity, fair play. They are the elements that make freedom necessary, but it's our responsibility. And when you look at the engagement of folks in voting in our Commonwealth and elsewhere, the engagement of folks in service opportunities around the nation, they are substandard, and they help explain, I think, why so much of our democracy is in peril, frankly.
We tend to, it's easy to see the deterioration of civics education, the impact that it has on government, the gridlock, the inability to form compromise, et cetera. Now that you're in business, talk to us a little bit about the impact that you see in the deterioration of civics from that business perspective.
Well, look, you know, I've spent most of my life in the private sector, as you may know, and I've done business and helped solve problems all over the world. In most of the rest of the world, Tom, I wonder if you'd agree with this, the bright line between business and government is a lot less bright, meaning there's a lot more collaboration. And frankly, I think some of the best results we got in my time in office, and some of the best results I see in other places around the country, is where business, philanthropy, and government are working together to solve the challenges facing us as human beings. And so, but if you don't understand how government works, if you simply see government as that thing over there, it's all about what is broken and them and not, in fact, us, and stop taking responsibility for it personally, then we get what we get. That's the thing about democracy, you know? If you want, you know, in a democracy, you get the government you deserve. And if you don't engage, we don't get the kind of government we deserve.
So you're a lawyer by training.
I am.
Our previous speaker, Attorney General Farmer, is a lawyer. It does seem that...
Careful now. You're not about to make a lawyer dig in front of all these business people, are you?
I'm counting heads, how many lawyers there are in the room. But it does seem to me that lawyers do have a basis in the civics education. Perhaps it's the legal training that you go through, that there's a basis there. And it's easier maybe for lawyers to advocate for why the rest of the nation needs to have that kind of civics background. But the rest of the nation, most of the rest of the nation, aren't lawyers. How do we make the case to the folks who aren't going to law school, or frankly aren't even going to college in America, still a majority of young Americans when they graduate high school, that they need to understand the importance of civics and why it matters to them and what they're going to do?
Well, you know, we you're right. In law school, we get to study the Constitution closely and the interpretations of it over time. But the truth about democracy is it's personal. It's individual. Not all the folks who sat around those tables in what is now called Independence Hall were lawyers. They were engaged individuals who understood that they were framing not you know, something that was going to be set on automatic pilot, but they were framing around these ideas of principles ways that that people could engage in this extraordinary experiment of self-government. And we have to own that. We have to care about that. It's not that complicated when you get down to it, but it is remarkable how a generation or two of careless rhetoric and treating our democracy as if it could handle infinite abuse without breaking has brought us to this point. I was saying to one of our colleagues today that when I was in office, and this is the first office I ever held, and I go in and I hear numbers of members of the legislature refer to the three branches, the governor's office, the House, and the Senate. I understood what they were saying, but that's not actually how it works. And you know, I'm repeating myself really, but there's a carelessness that we have had about our about government. Some of it, you know, some of the disdain, you know, earned, but there's a carelessness about it and a sense of distance that. And a lack of personal responsibility that I think we have let go for a long time. And I will say, you know, I'm a Democrat. I'm not a Democrat. I don't think you have to hate Republicans to be a good Democrat. Right? But we've started down this path where it's not just that you disagree, but that you are evil if you have a different point of view. When in fact we know in our own lives that no one person or no one party has a corner on all the best ideas.
This is personal for you, not just in the sense of having served as governor, but you were considering running for president.
Oh, gracious. Not here.
No announcement today. But you gave a remarkable quote at one point. I don't know if someone caught you off guard or, you know, in a moment of truth, but you said one of the reasons that you didn't get into the race, to paraphrase, was the cruelty of the current political process. Mm. And I think that's what you're talking about. Tell us a little bit how, if President Jefferson was optimistic about the future, whether or not you're optimistic that we can move past this cruelty that's preventing really qualified, exceptional individuals like yourself from getting into the ring.
Well, that's kind of you to say. I am optimistic so long as we start to take responsibility for the solutions, so long as we say, you know what, we're not going to look past callous and cruel or unlawful behavior, that is going to be a disqualifier. Even if they align around a handful of policy issues that are our own. And by the way, I'm not making a sub rosa comment about anyone. I really am not. I think we have our bad actors, you know, across the spectrum. And there ought to be a political consequence for that, you know. I get the part grudgingly that politics is sort of a blend of substance and performance art. I kind of get that. It took me a while to get that, but I get it. But I think we have come so that we're celebrating and focused on the performance art and less the substance. And as I say, I think we all have to take responsibility for that and show some leadership in the sense of trying to point us by our favor, by our support in a better direction.
If one side of the coin is we have to hold individuals accountable for behavior and rhetoric that's out of bounds, is the other side of the coin that we need to do a better job of rewarding those who actually do seek compromise?
I agree with that, very much so. And by the way, compromise isn't always just splitting the dollar. Right? It's hard to compromise a foundational principle. I understand that. But there ought to be, this is sort of back to the point I was making, that we don't have to agree on everything before we work together on anything. That there is a notion you are not qualified to be in the room if you don't already agree with me. When I was running the first time, I used to say to folks, you know, I'm not going to, you know, I have a point of view on a whole bunch of issues, but I don't know all I need to know. I don't understand your perspective or your perspective, teach me. And we'll fuss and fight, and we may or may not get to a better place, but let's all agree that we're trying to get to a better place. And if you don't vote for me, vote for somebody.
Just vote.
Show up and take responsibility for your own civic and political future. And you know, I think that was a message that resonated then. I think it still resonates.
We tend to think about compromise between the parties, between Republicans and Democrats. But when you were governor, you had a Democratic legislature. And in fact, today, I think it's something like 76% of Americans live in a state that is unified government. Mm-hmm. It's either all red or it's all blue. Mm-hmm. In those type of situations, in the Commonwealth that you led, how does compromise fit in within the party?
So I have to giggle because you know, we have Democrats who'd be Republicans if they live someplace else. I mean, it's a whole spectrum. And you folks here may not know, Massachusetts has more unenrolled independents than it does registered Republicans and registered Democrats combined. Combined. We're thought of as a very blue state, but in fact, I think it's indicative of how most people are. They're not buying 100% of what either party is selling. They're making decisions as they go. And as a practical matter, you know, we didn't, the dynamic in Massachusetts is not so much Democrat Republican as it is insider outsider. It's a very tight, inward looking political culture. And by the way, a whole lot of people around the country feel that way about Washington.
Whoever's inside, outside.
Who's ever in charge, that there's an inward looking dynamic and everybody else is secondary. And I think we're seeing, I mean, that's a whole other panel.
Is that a little bit of what President Trump tapped into?
I think it's, you know, one of the truths in my view that candidate Trump spoke was that conventional or establishment politics isn't working very well for a lot of people. Senator Sanders said the same thing. Mm-hmm. Senator Obama, when he was running for president, said the same thing a decade and a half before. And people are still feeling it. I don't think the answer to that is to say, let's burn it all down. I do think the answer to that is to say, you know, our systems are worthy and can withstand scrutiny, reform, and improvement without feeling that we just have to, you know, break it all and then take our chances after that.
Candidate Obama was successful on that type of message, and I think you're right about this inside-outside feeling, and was elected in part, I think, of identifying that problem. Candidate Trump did the same thing. What does it say, and what do we need to learn from individuals who identified that problem, each one election, very different policy views, obviously different parties, about what they've identified may be right, but the solution we haven't quite found yet. So what's part of the solution? If they're identifying, if two folks from opposite ends of the spectrum are identifying the right problem, what do we need to identify as the right solution?
Well, honestly think that if you're thinking generationally, as I think we should, that civics education is a big part of it. But as the professor said, I think there's a lot to like about service as well. That notion of coming together and being outward facing, trying to address some of our yawning national needs, whether they are in the military or on the civilian side. And I think, you know, for me, as profound as the foreign interference in the 2016 election is the fact that it was so easy. Mm. And I'm not talking about the technology intervention, but that painting a cartoon of our fellow citizens is very easily accepted today because we don't know each other anymore. And we need to find ways, I think, so alongside civics education, which I realize is the central theme today, service enables us to come together to learn about each other without just kind of sitting across the table and saying, now tell me about you, but working alongside each other toward a common goal. So I do think these are parts of the same solution. And I think that the accountability with which we as leaders in this room, hold our elected officials, particularly since so many of us have access to power, and what we model in our leadership and in our associations, I think is enormously important too.
So I know you're a proponent of a national service type system. The professor talked about the Israeli system and the benefits it gets. You're also involved in a pretty unique program in Israel and Palestine that builds on that community by bringing folks together in an entrepreneurial aspect as a way of forging relationships around business.
Our generation speaks.
I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about that program and what we might learn from it for our push for civics, particularly for a bunch of business leaders.
Well, so this is a program that really was born out of an extraordinary young man who was a former IDF intelligence officer in Israel and a student in Massachusetts at Brandeis. And I went to an event where I was supposed to talk about the couple of trade missions that we had done while in office to great effect to Israel. And I was going to be introduced by a very prominent member of our community and a friend. And the warm-up act was this student, and he totally stole the show.
Don't you hate it when that happens?
I hated it. But he described growing up in a small town near Jerusalem, very conservative environment, and getting coming to his time of service, and where he had to be in surveillance of families in Gaza. And he said, "These are it's the first time he'd ever actually seen any Palestinians. He had a point of view about Palestinians, but he said, watching them, they looked like us, they behaved like us, they were worrying about the same things, what time to get dinner on and how to get the kids to bed and the rest of it. And he said, it appeared to him there was never going to be a solution until, his words, they'd built an infrastructure of hope. And when I left office, he connected with me and he said, I have an idea about bringing entrepreneurs together from the Palestinian side and the Israeli side to work on developing business ideas together over the summer in Brandeis, and then sending them back into the region to launch those businesses. And I remember when we took the, so I chaired the advisory board to get it going. We took, after a couple of classes, the advisory board back to the region to visit with the entrepreneurs and to assess how the businesses were doing and how they were doing. And when we got these couple of classes together at that point, maybe 30, 40, the bond between them was so strong, and it caused you to wonder whether the most important part of the program was the success of the businesses or the success of the relationships. My point is that we learned about, in very real ways, how powerful it is when people have to do something together and begin to find their way across their differences, and in fact realize how de minimis those differences are in a very, very fundamental.
Our generation speaks.
It's
a great opportunity for the rest of us to check out what you're doing. Thank you for what you did in Massachusetts. Thank you for what you're continuing to do and leading the cause for civics and civility.
Thank you very much for having me. Good morning, everybody.